As you know, the National Led government was elected 5 years ago with a wide-ranging plan to lift New Zealand's economic performance so we could provide opportunities for New Zealanders to get ahead. Along the way, our country has faced a number of significant challenges, including natural disasters, a domestic recession, and of course the global financial crisis. But through it all, we've remained on track, we haven't panicked, and we've done what we said that we would do. Well, I believe we've made good progress in dealing with these challenges and building a more prosperous New Zealand, but we still have plenty of work ahead of us. So today I am joined by Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance Bill English. Last Friday at Premier House, Bill provided our caucus with an update on the economy and the government's fiscal position. He's going to share some of those thoughts with you now, then we'll take questions on anything you might have in that particular area, and then there'll be just a number of other things I need to run through in terms of the normal agenda.
Well, thank you, Prime Minister. As the Prime Minister said, it's 5 years since we were elected. In 2008, we were guided by two goals: to give New Zealanders a sense of security in difficult times and to set the economy on a growth path. We said we would tackle the issues that were already holding New Zealand back before the global financial crisis occurred. So under the Prime Minister's strong and positive leadership, we've made good progress, and we believe we are headed in the right direction and will continue with that direction. The economy grew by around 2.5% in the past year, and the forecasts are for growth around that level or perhaps a bit more over the next couple of years. While that sounds modest by some historical standards, it would leave us among the world's strongest developed economies. Businesses are more confident than they've been for a while, and that's important for rebuilding investment intentions. Last week we saw unemployment coming down further against the background of increasing participation, which was pleasing, but unemployment is still higher than we would like. We believe families and households have shown considerable resilience over recent years, and the indications are that their confidence is picking up. They're enjoying low interest rates, still the lowest in 50 years, relatively low cost of living increases, moderate wage increases, and this is starting to show through in growing consumption. The government's getting its own books in order. We're on track for a surplus in 2014-15, and we'll have choices once we get to surplus about repaying debt and other priorities. And New Zealanders are getting better public services with improving results in difficult areas like educational achievement, welfare dependency, vulnerable children and law and order. So our message for the next year or two is that we have an opportunity to really test how much we can improve on those indicators of a healthy community. How many more young people can we get across the line for NCA level 2? How many more vulnerable children can we reach with early childhood education? How many more vulnerable families can we keep out of welfare and get into work and self-sufficiency? If we can answer that question with some real ambition, we can improve the government's fiscal outlook further, as well as improve our communities. So as we look ahead, we need to continue focusing on a strong and competitive economy. In 5 weeks' time, I'll deliver the half-year update. We're still finalising the forecasts, and we'll also at that time be setting out the budget policy statement. The update, I think, will reflect the fact that there's good momentum building in the economy, but there are going to be some challenges. Getting back to surplus remains a significant challenge. We've successfully managed our core fiscal position by focusing on the drivers of our expenditure and getting better results. So although the economy is improving and revenue is increasing, there are other significant influences on the government's books. For example, in the past 5 years, the government's balance sheet, that is the what the taxpayer owns, has changed significantly. I'll just give you some indications of that. Net core crown debt has climbed from $10 billion in 2008 to $60 billion this year. was forecast to exceed $70 billion before it comes down. EQC's natural disaster fund, which stood at $5.5 billion in 2008, has been cleaned out. On behalf of taxpayers, the government paid out $2 billion to finance company depositors at a net cost of $844 billion after recoveries. Another $350 million for AMI insurance rescue package. The big changes for government assets. ACC's investment fund has in the past 5 years increased from $9.6 billion to $24.6 billion, and the New Zealand Super Fund has increased from $14 billion to $23 billion. So this means that there's a growing prominence and therefore a growing effect of financial assets and liabilities on the government's track to surplus. And it means that it is now influenced by more volatility, that is the value of those large investments and the liabilities we've taken on can go up and down considerably, affected by such changes, such things as changes in interest rates and discount rates. And of course we've seen the financial performance of SOEs affected by the aftermath of the global financial crisis. There's, I think people now understand, there's no guaranteed profitability about the businesses owned or partially owned by the Crown. So while the update on December 17th is likely to confirm that we're on track to surplus, it will be a small surplus, not a large one. And that's why the Prime Minister indicated last week that there isn't going to be the room for some large-scale election year lolly sprinkle, much as our opponents seem to be promoting that idea. Somehow the success of fiscal management up to now means that the benefits can all be thrown away. The government has made good progress over the last 5 years with some fairly innovative fiscal management alongside conventional economic policy, but we will need to stick to that direction, and that will become clear with the half-year update. We believe our program is working and we're seeing results, and that's why we will step to that path. Prime Minister. Questions?
What do you see as the single greatest potential obstacle to getting surplus?
Look, it would just be that the core government revenue and spending is in pretty good shape, but the accounting impact of this now large growth of financial assets is a bit unpredictable. And when you're aiming for a very small difference between large numbers, I think in the budget the surplus was around $70 million on a spending base of $70 billion. So you're trying to hit you're trying to land on a penny in the middle of a storm. So the accounting effect of all those assets can create uncertainty.
So is it likely to be smaller than that $70 million now?
Oh, look, all I'm saying is it would be smaller. The accountants are still yet to complete their magic on it.
A month ago, you said we were well on track. So what's happened in the last month that gives you, sounds like you're preparing us for the fact that it might not happen?
Oh, I don't think we can be accused of being over-optimistic about the surplus. I've been pretty confident about it in the sense that we've got a good grip on the drivers of spending and the usual political pressures that you might have expected, when we started out 3 or 4 years ago, haven't turned out to be as strong. So the public perception of public services has lifted quite a bit. They see, as indicated by the latest Kiwi Count survey from the State Services Department, where people have a higher level of trust and a better experience of service. So that, I think, indicates we've got the balance about right between tight management but good service.
Well, on some of those accounting things like ACC and the Common Fund, haven't you been doing better than you would have expected recently? Are you warning us that this can't go on forever and that between now and 2015 there could be a downturn in the world equity markets that would have impact on your service? Is that what you're saying?
Oh, no, I'm just simply pointing out that the Some budgets you'll find it works for you, a discount rate changes or an interest rate changes, and that helps. But as our economy normalises a bit around growth, there's just a certain amount of volatility there that you don't know which way it's going to go. I mean, just by way of a couple of examples, the actuaries might decide, for instance, as they have in the past, that the incomes of people who hold student loans are going to grow a bit faster or a bit slower than they thought. That can have an effect of 100 or 200 million. ACC or the super fund can change the mix of their fixed interest versus equities holdings, and when they do that, it changes the interest income recorded in the government accounts. I'm not expecting people to get excited about this stuff. All I'm saying is that the ownership of this wide range now of financial instruments through the investment funds and the big liabilities associated with the earthquake just make it a bit trickier.
But don't you target the opening up, which excludes those big gains and losses from those assets and loans?
Well, as it happens, it excludes some of the gains and losses, but not all of them. And this is an art, not a science. I mean, the Obergale was a sensible effort by Dr. Cullen to remove some of the volatility, but you can't get rid of all of it. I mean, on the total operating measure, we're in surplus now. By the measure that most other governments would use, we've got a surplus of $2 or $3 billion now.
Does all this argue for a change to the accounting treatment? I mean, do you need sort of Obergale? No?
Well, that's possible, and I'll keep an eye on the Dominion because no doubt a proposition will appear soon.
So, Minister, I mean, having given up this volatility and all that, do you ever regret having made such a big deal about setting this target?
No, because I think it's proven to be a very effective anchor for the public expectations, the politicians making decisions, and for the public service. And what's impressive, really, is that despite in the light of the fact that anchor was set 3 or 4 years ago when we had a 9% of GDP deficit 3 years ago, that we managed to get just about there, but not quite there yet, at the same time as improving the provision of public service is pretty remarkable.
But if you don't hit it, then it will be seen as a failure, regardless of all of this, the volatility and the difficulty of doing it, the big numbers and so on. It will be a failure one day.
Well, we intend to.
Last year, I think it was the high flu, you added a head-sized petrol tax, which helped you get across the line in forecasting. You're trying to get rid of that now? Can you need that too?
Oh, the petrol excise tax is built into the 7-year plan for infrastructure road building, so it's all needed.
Why are you saying it's going to be a challenge to get to surplus when economists are saying we're looking at 3.5-4% growth in the next year? Surely that makes it difficult for what you do. Are you saying that they're a bit too optimistic about growth forecast?
Well, a couple of points here. First is Treasury has had reasonably optimistic forecasts in the last budget. So the economic growth now is about where they said it would be. So there's not a lot of upside there. Some economists have moved to a more positive view than they had. Secondly, the impact you can get from greater tax revenue or lower benefit spending, both of which are happening to some extent, can be offset simply by the size of these other accounting effects. Okay? I guess that's the point, that because there's been something of a misleading impression that because we've been doing asset sales, that somehow the government's got less assets. As I pointed out, the super fund's gone from 14 billion to 23 billion in 5 years, and ACC's had a bigger increase from 9.6 billion to 24.6 billion over that 5-year period. And that now has a much bigger influence on the Obergale than I think is well understood.
It does sound like your track to growth is lower than the private sector economists there. You said 2.5% in the next 2 years at the start of this year, I think. They're looking more at 3+. Are you saying Treasury is undershooting those forecasts?
Oh, but I haven't. I'll see their final forecast for the half year update, and they may be up a bit. But we're not going to see significant windfall gains for the surplus over the next year or two out of that. There's not really any plausible growth track that generates surplus.
So are you telling us that it had not been for the improvement of the investment position for ACC and the New Zealand Super Fund, you definitely wouldn't be making surplus of 14%?
No, I'm just saying that the growth of that kind of asset makes the business of getting the surplus fairly tricky. Okay, so it's not as if the growth of them, you know, the way our measures work, the growth of those investment funds has no impact on the overgoal, but the way they change in value and makeup can have an impact. And because they're now so big, much bigger than the value of the SOEs, for instance, they can kick your surplus around. Point there, I think, is that despite the fact that there's a bit of confidence about growth in the economy, people shouldn't be expecting some large unexpected surplus windfall.
At the moment, aren't they kicking the surplus around upwards?
Well, there's a number of different influences there, but a number of them are negative.
Have you decided conclusively whether you're going to revise the 5% dividend target at this point?
It'll have to be revised by, we don't get to decide that. I mean, just the true and fair presentation of our accounts will require a revision. And the biggest single change is likely to be around solid energy. So bear in mind, when that target was set, solid energy was valued at, you know, well over 1.5 to 2 billion. At one stage, it was valued over 3 billion. So that's certainly not in shape to be sold now. Its current value is probably closer to zero. So that will be the single biggest difference, not so much the fluctuation in values of the electricity companies, it's the absence of solid energy that makes the difference.
So you must buy?
Well, we'll wait and see, but it does have to be re-estimated, and that'll be quite transparent.
Does this mean that you are on track to reduce the net debt to below 20% by 2020?
I think you'll have to wait and see. The debt picture is a bit different. But I wouldn't want to get into speculating about that until we've got it set down. Just bear in mind that last year we came in about $3 billion ahead on the deficit, so that means actually lower net debt. So we'll see how that pans out. I'm a bit more optimistic about that.
Can you explain more specifically how the Cullen Fund and ACC Fund impact on the surplus if they don't and are not an overgoal?
Okay, well, there's a number of different ways, and I wouldn't want to pretend that this is comprehensive, because I think the, you know, we're still really getting a full understanding of it. One of the most obvious ways is just the tax they pay. So, and that depends on how much of their growth and value is taxable versus how much is it, and that can vary widely. Okay, but hard to predict. The second thing is that. And this might sound a bit odd, right? So when they hold a fixed income security, the interest, like a bond, an Australian government bond or something, the interest on it is counted in our overgoal, or counts towards our overgoal. If they sell fixed interest securities and buy shares, then it reduces the interest income. So it's just an accounting effect, really. It doesn't change the value of the fund. It's not relevant to any specific decision that we make. Now, that's just two examples, and there may well be others as we dig further into it. Again, the point is not so much the detail of it, it's that this misleading idea that the government owns some electricity companies and not much else simply isn't correct. We've got this large range of financial assets. They're all incorporated into the surplus track, and because they're now so much bigger than they used to be, they're having more impact, and it makes hitting surplus a bit more complex.
Does this mean that going into the next election, for the budget next year, you won't have much flexibility for any sort of pre-election promises or tax cuts?
Look, there won't be room for big lolly scrambles. I think that's pretty clear. I wouldn't want to prejudge the budget forecasts. Remember, there's three reports between now and the election: the half-year update, the budget, and then the pre-election update. And the way that when you see the changes in confidence and employment and investment, that are going on. You know, it could be that we see a rising plane of forecasts through that period. That would be positive. It doesn't all flow automatically into war cash for governments to spend.
So just to be clear, are you saying that the profits from the asset sales won't scrape over the $5 billion mark now? That will be revised down?
No, I'm just saying there will be a revised... The current estimate on the books is $5 to $7 billion, and they just use the midpoint figure, okay, or $6 billion. There will be an updated estimate, that will be announced in the half-year update. The biggest difference is the absence of solid energy. That's the biggest single factor.
ACC, in its annual results, did better than forecast and also did better in terms of what it was forecast to contribute to the overgrowth. We expect that the other lights in New Zealand signal, for the reasons you just outlined a few moments ago, will have a negative effect?
They could have. Look, there's a whole lot of different. You take something like ACC, there's their insurance expenses, and then there's their liability unwind. It's a nightmare of complexity and detail. But the fact that you've got a growing economy doesn't guarantee that their impact on the books is positive. Partly because the way actuaries make assumptions, economic forecasters make assumptions, and for instance, I use the example about the student loans, where they, despite the fact the economy is growing, they're revising their assumption about the growth of incomes of student borrowers. And that can give you plus or minus a couple of $100 million easier. So the same sorts of things go on with ACC, the same sorts of things go on with all the Canterbury insurance liabilities. Compared to our target, they're quite large differences. I guess that's my point. We're not talking about $50 million up against a surplus of $100 million. We're talking about hundreds of millions either way up against that surplus.
In your summary of the 5 years, you didn't mention the external sector, the current account deficits, and whether there's been improvement in the export share of the economy. Do you think that's the one disappointment to that?
I wouldn't say it's a disappointment. It's a reality that in particular, the US economy has not recovered in the way that people might have expected 5 or 6 years ago. That's meant that our dollar relative to theirs has been high, and that's been a headwind for the growth of the export sector. And our response to that has been to focus on competitiveness. I think if you look back, that's been pretty successful. We've got export growth despite the fact that it's an 80 plus cents US dollar and has been for 5 or 6 years. If we really want to rebalance the economy much further, we will need the US economy to recover, for the US dollar to pick up and give our exporters a bit more profitability. Now, just figures in the last day show that effect. US payroll is better than expected, the US dollar's up a bit. Talking about tapering in December, where previously there's been discussion there wouldn't be tapering until 2016, 2017. It's quite unpredictable. But in the long run, I believe, and it's just a belief, that the US dollar will strengthen sometime, and that our export sector will be in a very good position to take advantage of that.
Are you prepared to cut spending a little bit harder, impose more cuts over the food?
We think it's quite important to get to surplus, very important, just as a waypost of success and an indicator that the people can have the confidence that the government's books are under control. We don't imagine significant service cuts to achieve. I think we've shown that we are able to make progress in pretty sensible and moderate ways without cutting service to the public. The public regard public services more favourably than they did 5 or 6 years ago, and we want to keep that going.
One direct way that ACC does affect the balance is in terms of the levies that are connected. You indicated earlier this year that maybe $300 million worth of ACC has recommended much deeper cuts than that, and you're currently considering its recommendations at the moment. But can we expect that it's likely to be more like $300 million or even less than that, so if the getting back to surface is so important to you?
Well, we've in the process of considering that, so we'll let you know where we get to. But you know, the government's surplus track is a bit of a constraint on the extent to which, on the speed at which you can reduce ACC debt. Bear in mind here, they've reduced by, and the way they impact on the books is quite complicated because of all the actuarial elements. So a reduction in levies, you know, just by way of illustration, of $10 can have a $15 to $20 impact on our books. So we pay quite a bit of attention to that. But that's against the background where we've now had 2 years of levy reductions, and we would imagine a series of further levy reductions out over the next 2 or 3 years. It's really just a matter of the speed in which they occur.
Can I ask the same question in a slightly different way? What's more important, returning to surplus or ensuring that New Zealand households and businesses retain as much of the money that they earn as possible in order that they can pay down debt, invest, and all those other good things that come from having that extra money?
Well, both of those things are very important, and it's our job to find the balance.
Okay. So turning to other matters now, today I'm announcing that I'll travel to Sri Lanka for the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting on Thursday. I'll then fly on to Bangkok, where I'll be joined by a business delegation. My plans originally included travelling to the Philippines with the business delegation. However, we're now in discussions with the Philippines as to whether this visit can actually go ahead. In the wake of the devastation caused by Typhoon Haiyan, and after discussions with the Philippines, we have offered to postpone the visit so that the Philippine government can concentrate resources where they are best needed. We'll let you know our decision once we've had a response from the Philippines. Once again, I'd like to offer President Aquino and the people of the Philippines New Zealand's heartfelt condolences at the tragic loss of life. We remain committed to helping wherever we can. Over the weekend, the government announced an initial contribution of $150,000 towards the Philippines via the Red Cross. This afternoon, Foreign Minister Murray McCulley also announced a further contribution of $2 million. It's my intention to call President Aquino and convey New Zealand's condolences personally when he's able to take my call, which will be in the next 24 hours, and we'll just have an opportunity to touch base on whether the trip to the Philippines can actually go ahead. We depart for CHOGM in Colombo on Thursday evening. Let me also acknowledge that today is Armistice Day, and that on the 11th hour, the 11th day of the 11th month in 1918, the First World War ended. 18,000 New Zealanders were killed in the conflict, and 95 years on, continue to remember their sacrifice. In the House this week, the government intends to progress the Members of Parliament Remuneration and Services Bill, the Health and Safety Pikewa Implementation Bill, and the New Zealand International Convention Centre Bill is going to get its third reading. Wednesday is a Members' Day. Questions?
Indian leader has decided not to go to China.
Mama Hunting.
Have you given any consideration to the trip we've got back together in that single line?
No, we're definitely going to go to Sri Lanka. I mean, it's our view that this isn't a bilateral visit to Sri Lanka. It just happens to be that Sri Lanka is the host of the Commonwealth Heads of Government. This is the 22nd of such events. We've been to all of the others. And while one or two leaders have taken a view that they're not going to go, the vast bulk of over 50 are attending.
What about putting pressure on for Sri Lanka to relinquish the chair?
Yeah, there's no mechanism for doing that. The appointment as chair took place effectively when they were named as the host back in Perth in 2011. So I don't think there's a mechanism for that actually taking place. And practically speaking, the main function of the chair is really to host the event, which is taking place obviously this week.
So what views are you going to put to Rajapaksa when you meet with him, if any, about human rights abuses and the method of investigation?
Well, the first thing I'd say is that we take the issue of human rights in Sri Lanka seriously. The Foreign Minister has met twice with the government in the last 12 months or so to discuss these issues. He's also going to be on the visit with me. He tends to go up north firsthand to have a look at that. We're also requesting a meeting with the President of Sri Lanka. Assuming that meeting takes place, then we'll be putting on the table our concerns and urging them to address the issues that are taking place in their country. But my own view is that if we were to boycott, we wouldn't achieve anything. The meeting would still go ahead. In fact, actually, by hosting the meeting in Sri Lanka, we take the New Zealand media with us, as do leaders from around the world, and that, if anything, shines a light on what's happening in Sri Lanka.
Sri Lanka, do you accept the assurances that she had a problem with the visa? Because she hasn't, she both advised me and sought the right channels to make sure that's right.
Yeah, look, I don't have all of the details of exactly the visa that she travelled to Sri Lanka on. I was advised early evening last night that there was a problem and that the Green Party were else asking for our support. In fact, gave that assistance along with the Australians. And my understanding is she took what was her scheduled flight back to New Zealand. So whether she was on the right visa or the wrong visa or permitted to do what she was permitted to do, I don't know. I'll accept it at this stage that it was a visa issue and not a freedom of speech issue.
Like they were trying to shut down a press conference with opposition in Sri Lanka. I mean, surely that's not particular.
And that's possible, but I don't have all of those details. All I can say is that we're going to go there. Hopefully the Commonwealth will be able to go about its work, its important meeting that it holds, and we will have an opportunity to make our feelings clear to the President about concerns we hold from some years back and potentially ongoing concerns about human rights issues in Sri Lanka.
Did you manage to have a last month in New York? Did you manage human rights issues with him there?
Yeah, so at the meeting there, I indicated to him that New Zealand closely follows the issues of human rights, and I reminded him of the fact that the Foreign Minister had, on a couple of occasions, raised those issues.
How confident are you that the New Zealand media accompanying you will be able to shine a light on what's happening in Sri Lanka, given the Sri Lankan government has clamped down on its own media for years?
Yeah, so I mean, you're broadcasting over our networks, and that's in a free and totally uncontrolled way is normal in New Zealand, and that will continue. So you will continue to report on what you see and what you hear on an unfiltered basis, as it should be. I accept it might be different in Sri Lanka, but it's also true it's very different in many countries around the world, and that doesn't stop us travelling there.
But the Sri Lankan government aren't putting restrictions, aren't they, on visiting journalists in terms of their keys and access to the meetings?
Well, they may well do, but I mean, in the end, my experience of New Zealand journalists who've travelled with me overseas is that they do their level best to get a feeling of what's really happening on the ground. They go out themselves and look and see what's happening. They'll be talking to the Foreign Minister, who will be up north. No doubt you'll go and ask people who live there what they think is really happening. So, I mean, in one sense, as I say, the international pressure that comes on Sri Lanka from being the host of Commonwealth Heads meeting is, in one sense, could be a very positive thing. Yeah, I don't know if I'd choose between them all because they all have different roles. I mean, APEC is very much an economic organisation, East Asian Summit has a wider remit, but New Zealand's a proud Commonwealth country, it always has been, and I think in that regard it plays a role of binding the Commonwealth together. For New Zealand, it has some advantages in that the bulk of the Commonwealth is obviously made up of African nations and nations from the Caribbean. So they're countries increasingly we engage with, in the case of the UN Security Council, nations that were looking to try and support us for our bid for the Security Council seat. So it's a useful forum, but it's different from the others.
Would the partner for Mr. McKellar,
sorry, what
was
that?
It
can be. I mean, at the 2011 meeting, which 2009, which was in Trinidad and Tobago, the French President Sarkozy at the time took the step of coming out to lobby that group and to share his perspectives on climate change. So I think it's still got relevancy.
What concerns are you going to convey to the President? What specifically are you concerned about?
Well, I think there's a number of things. I mean, the first is we'll want to talk about what actually took place as they dealt with the issues around their civil war and historical issues. Secondly, engagement that they are having with the Tamils. And thirdly, ongoing issues. I mean, one issue is that they've recently dismissed their Supreme Court judge. They're the Supreme Court. Probably want to ask them about those issues and what led to that.
We were meeting with Kim and McCully about attending CHOGM and the effect of the Sri Lanka. Was there any discussion or any possibility raised of reduced participation by New Zealand?
No, not as my understanding. I mean, my understanding of the history of all of this is that back in 2009 at Trinidad, there was discussion about Sri Lanka heading, well, hosting the event in 2011. There was a deal that was brokered back then that in fact Australia would host it in Perth, and then Sri Lanka would be the host in 2013, with the CHOGM played out.
So New Zealand never considered sending a foreign minister as opposed to prime minister?
No, I mean, we've been aware for some time that the Canadians were going, or the Prime Minister Harper wasn't going, and in the very recent times that Manmohan Singh wasn't attending. We've had discussions internally, as you'd expect, you know, that just to kick the tires, that we're comfortable with the steps we're taking. But we are, and yeah, while we accept it's unusual that a couple of countries aren't going, and they have their own reasons for doing that, we're also in very good company. I mean, the British Prime Minister will be there. Ultimately, you know, Tony Abbott will be there. Many, many other leaders from around the world will be there.
Have you met with any of the Tamil refugees in New Zealand?
I've been out to the odd Sri Lankan Day celebration, so yeah, I've met them there, but I can't recall formally whether I've met them in recent times, so I don't think I have open check marks.
Well, I agree with you, David Cameron's
done his. I don't know if there's been a request that we could answer, so I've been to those events, and I've certainly met plenty of people. I don't think there's been a formal request, but I'd like to check my office.
We've heard today that 32 MPs are effectively using their accommodation allowance to pay the sales rent and also keep that capital gains. Is that a rort?
No, it's not a rort. I mean, there is a system that's been established for quite some time about the way assets are recorded in an MP's pecuniary interest. And my expectations are that my MPs, because obviously every MP from every party has to comply, and I can't speak for them, but in terms of our MPs, my expectations is that they will comply fully. The advice I have received is that they have. Now, in fact, actually, as you may have seen from the newspaper reporting, quite a number of my MPs actually actively sought to actually give greater levels of clarity and information, and the Registrar of Pecuniary Interests encourage them not to do that, and actually rejected recording that information.
Do you think they should be able to keep that capital gains, or
even that? Well, I think you're talking about their investments they hold in the superannuation fund, and again, my expectations would be that they would comply with the law. I mean, ultimately, you can have an economic debate about whether they own a hard asset like a property, or shares in Goodman's Property Trust. Both are one and the same thing, effectively, their investments in real estate. So, you know, they just need to comply with the law like anybody else does.
So I'm not talking specifically about the superannuation, the properties for the superannuation funds, just the fact that MPs are using their accommodation allowance to effectively pay themselves, and they can get the capital gains on top of that, should they be allowed to do so.
Well, I expect them to comply with the law, but I think you can confuse these things. I mean, at the end of the day, they have a requirement to live in Wellington. How or where they live and how they fund that or pay for that is kind of a matter for the rules around Parliament. And in the end, if Parliament decides through the Business Committee and Parliamentary Services to review the rules, we'll be more than happy with that. More than happy to engage in that debate. And as a government, we've been extremely transparent about trying to increase the level of knowledge and information about the way MPs act and how they spend their own money and what expenses they have. But I don't think you can actually rightfully criticise MPs for following the law, taking advice from the Register and making sure that they have fully complied.
Are they 12% from taxpayer funded perks?
It depends on many other things. I mean, there's an argument that could be put up if they didn't own that property, they could ultimately own another property, and so you can get into some of the circular argument.
And should those all be changed in terms of new taxpayers?
There's challenges with that. Some time ago, I remember actively trying to, when the Registry of Pecuniary Interest first came out, actively wanting to list assets that were in the trust and having the Register actively telling me not to do that for a variety of reasons, not the least in being concerns about trust law at the time. So in the end, it's not straightforward. I mean, the decision has been taken that MPs should record trusts they have an interest in, superannuation funds they have an interest in, but not the individual assets contained in them.
Was there anything in that newspaper report this morning that you looked at that concerned you?
Well, I read it pretty briefly, but you know, the only question I actually asked was the obvious one, which is, have we had any advice that our people aren't following advice. There was no even receiving advice. They, to the contrary, they are actually complying with the rules.
The government trying to control gas price inflation, they're concerned about investment. But like the MPs own 5, 6, in my case 20 out of 20.
Well, I haven't seen the details of that, but I mean, again, anybody in New Zealand has a right or is able to own property. They need to make sure they comply with the law. And there are plenty of people who buy property who run foul of the tax laws because they don't understand it. You know, whether someone pays tax, that's not something you can actually determine from the registration or of ownership of a property. The property's bought, it's all to do with the intent rules we have in New Zealand, so I don't think you can draw that conclusion they are or aren't paying capital gains tax, they might be.
Does the fact that so many national MPs own investment properties influence your views on capital gains tax?
No. I mean, my view on capital gains tax has been a long-held view, and actually it's backed up by IRD, who don't believe that capital gains tax will gain much revenue, would be easy to administer, would be an efficient tax. Treasury have another view. Their view is that there is a place for capital gains tax, but in my view, given it's a realisation tax, and looking around the world, you can see a lot of countries that are struggling with their capital gains tax that don't work well. We also have a very simplified, rule-based, low-rate tax system in New Zealand. If you didn't have capital, if you had a capital gains tax, you'd almost certainly have to bring back death duties and gift duties and all sorts of other compounding issues. So it's a personal view, but I don't think there should be an extension of the current capital gains tax that we have in New Zealand.
Do you think personally that superannuation loophole needs to be closed in the interest of transparency?
Well, I don't think it's a loophole. I think it's the way the rules were actually designed. No one's going around the rules, they're actually playing with the rules. So in the end, I mean, you know, there can be political debate about whether that should change, and if the view of parliamentary services via the Speaker and ultimately the other political parties is to change it, which will naturally stand in the way.
What's your view?
I wouldn't care if there was greater disclosure. I mean, generally the purpose around pecuniary interest is to make sure that external watchers of Parliament, aka the media, can actually see, as they should be entitled to, in my view, what assets an MP has an interest in, and then make sure that they are properly discharging their responsibilities, given that they are in an influential role in making the laws. So my view, more information is usually better than less, but that's also going to be balanced up against the fact that this is a static declaration, happens once a year, so it's not updated during the year. It's administered, so ultimately you've got to make sure you're not overloading the place with too much bureaucracy and information.
Can you expand on the point of why the Register of Pecuniary Interests wants people not to disclose what assets are in trust, or it's any MP's business if they want to put it out on the table and they're not going to be bullied by the Register?
Yeah, so you have to go and ask what Martin Weaver's view is these days. It may have changed back from Margaret Bassey, but at the time, all I can tell you is way back when it first came in 2005, I was extremely careful about assets they held in the trust and wanting to make sure I could disclose those, and we were actively advised not to do that.
Can we discuss today at all any issues around compensation for families of the Waikato?
Not really. The Attorney General indicated the position that is known, which is the government's view is that we shouldn't pick up the compensation that the courts awarded to the families but was payable by the company.
So no decisions have been made?
Well, the decision has been made.
But by CHOGM?
Well, essentially there's no decision to be made. I mean, the issue is that we think in law that debt should be serviced by the company, not by the Crown. And in the event that the cartel won't be paid by the company, then ultimately if there is any recourse to the government, we can't see that legal recourse, and we think that, that should be tested if the families ultimately want to do that.
There's a book coming out this week that's going to be quite damning about Waikato. Do you think New Zealand Oil and Gas should have voted to compensate the families?
Look, I'll probably stay away from that. I mean, in the end, it's ultimately the legal responsibility of the Pike Group directors to work out. I mean, I've been active in the bottom that they researched me as part of it, so we'll see how it comes out in person.
Have you got any view on John Tamahir and what effects have been suspended
from that? No. I mean, in the end, I think that's a matter for radio lives management.
Before that,
look at the index for them to decide their own commercial, what they believe is commercially right and where they believe they're overlined. I didn't hear the interviews. I mean, I know that the interview took place and I've seen the media reports, but it was taken down offline before I could hear it.
You obviously made a stand about deciding not to go on the show for the rest of the year, so you missed the interview.
Well, I didn't actually have a scheduled date to go, so it wasn't as if I actually boycotted them, it's just that there wasn't a date set down on the diary. Had they asked me to go, then I would have had to think that through.
There is some speculation now about the police commissioner needing not necessarily to be a police officer in practice of Indian, might be better. Have you got a view on that?
It might technically be possible, and certainly in certain fields we see that as something that either can be an advantage or certainly not something that would stop someone doing the job. My gut instinct is it's better if the commissioner's a police officer, a former police officer. You're talking about leading a very large group of men and women. It's a complex area, a bit like the military. Having done time through the service over a long period of time adds to the moral authority. There's probably no legal reason why it couldn't happen.
Are you pleased that the police have appointed a basically mafia agency investigation team to look into the Roastbusters case?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of different parts to that particular case. I mean, in terms of whether the police were right not to follow the initial complaint with a formal prosecution, that's something I can't offer a view on because there's constabulary independence and I don't have all the facts. And I can never get access to those facts. So the only way of the public being satisfied about whether the police acted as they should have is for the IPCA to actually go and look at the file and make an assessment of that. So the good news part of the story there is at least people will be able to take some confidence that the watchdog will review the file. I think in terms of the kind of online bullying and intimidation that these guys have carried out via their Facebook site, that's something the government can directly control, and that's ultimately what the legislation last week is about. There's kind of a third bit of the debate, and that's ultimately, as I said, around sex education and ultimately about whether the rape laws in New Zealand are actually set in the right place. And the only thing I'd say about both of those latter issues is that it's a very delicate balance, and we've got to make sure that balance is held in the right place. That those who truly rape someone are held to account, but we also get a situation where people who haven't committed rape are all of a sudden prosecuted when they shouldn't be. It's a very delicate balance there.
Just back to the police investigation, though, are you saying mistakes were made initially even last week in the way it was handled, and they haven't played catch up now?
There's no question mistakes were made in so much that, as I said, the police minister was unaware that whatever the technical nature of those complaints, whether they were formal or informal, the police minister should have been aware of that, and in fact the commissioner should have been aware of it, and my understanding is neither of them were. That's definitely a mistake. Whether it was a mistake not to carry out a prosecution when the first complaint was made, I don't have any knowledge of that. I don't know. I can't assess it, but I know that the watchdog will be able to assess that.
In terms of the law, are you thinking...
Given housing shortages in Auckland and Christchurch, do you think National MPs should own, as is the case in some cases, 6 or 7 houses in Christchurch, 4 or several in Christchurch?
Well, I think the answer to the housing issues around New Zealand are ultimately supply-side issues, and the government is working with the Auckland Council to consent 39,000 homes over the course of the next 3 years. So, I think it would be a bit of a stretch to argue, because an MP owns a few houses, depending on where they are, that that's adding to the housing shortage. Second thing is, from time to time, we see stories about rental shortages. So ultimately, again, if it wasn't people who owned homes, it wouldn't be homes for people to rent.
Going back to Roastbusters and the law, are you having second thoughts about the move away from Simon Powers' inquisitorial approach?
No, we're just taking advice on the whole thing and having a look at where we might go next. All I'm saying is in that whole area, it's a delicate area that we just need to feel our way through carefully.
The Greens are asking for a cross-party group to look at those Royal Commission recommendations on sexual violence laws. Would you be open to that?
Might be. I mean, I haven't received any advice on that. We'll go away and have a look at it.
But officials are re-looking at those laws?
They're having a bit of a look behind the scenes, I think, yes.
Is that in addition to what you've informed that last week about the...
No, I think it's all in that space.
In the way- wake of this, will the government consider revising the cutbacks to support agencies for sexual violence services that have happened since it took office in 2008?
Yeah, I mean, you'd need to give me the specific agencies. I mean, I'm aware that there are some that have had changed their funding, but I mean, overall, I think our funding's actually increased. I mean, what the government has done over the course of the last 5 years, across a range of agencies, providing a range of services from budgeting to sexual support services, has been to assess whether we think the services actually provide a service that works and has been efficient. So some agencies have had their funding cut back, but not because the government's been looking to save money, but because it's held a view that the agency hasn't been as efficient or someone else is more efficient.
In terms of the specifics, I'm talking about the Auckland Rape Crisis Hotline, Wellington Rape Crisis, the fact that the acceptance of sensitive claims for ACC in terms of sexual abuse counselling and so forth have fallen from 60% in 2008 to 3.6% by 2011. I mean, what are the problems with these services that the government would see and cut that funding?
Well, each of them here, there's a different answer to the particular point you made. I can't give them to you because I don't have those facts actually with me, but I can get you an answer to them. I mean, all I can say is that a number of those different areas over time send advice about why particular changes were made that supported the view, but they weren't financially driven.
Right, what sort of reforms would you propose in a general sense for these agencies?
Well, it would depend on the agency and what they're doing.
Okay, for example, Wellington Rape Crisis.
Well, it's very specific, and as I say, I'm happy to get you an answer to that, but I'm not going to wing you an answer this afternoon.
Okay.
What's the biggest barrier to that 90% of women who don't come forward, women and men who don't come forward and report the tax?
I think that the system's particularly tough on them. They have to have their personal life exposed. They have to go through a trial, and that trial can be very harrowing. They probably will certainly run a risk that the defence will make them feel humiliated. So there's a lot of different factors in there that hold people back. So these things are never completely or very, very rarely completely clear cut. So that's one of the issues why people don't necessarily come forward. And that's a terrible thing. I'm just saying, ultimately, Parliament has to write the rules that are administered.